everybody. So my session is, the purpose of the session is to get inside what you saw this morning during the keynote about multithreading, specifically about what I said and what Jean-Pierre and Olivier demonstrated a few minutes ago. So the same slide for the keynote, the definition about cooperative and primitive. It's important to know the difference because I will talk a lot about these two terms during the session. So what is cooperative and what is primitive? So the cooperative mode, this is what you are using today with your 4D processes. Cooperative means that the 4D processes cooperate to share one CPU. They need to cooperate so that when one process must say, OK, I'm stopping my execution and give you my CPU. I give my CPU to another process. They cooperate together. Explicitly by using the idle command, you know that you must use the idle command in some case in your compile application, or implicitly by using most other 4D language command that internally call the idle command to give the CPU to another process, okay? As I said, because one process stops by using the idle command or any other command, and to give the CPU to another 4D process, that means that only one CPU core can be used at the same time. You can, of course, you know that from your 4D process, it seems natural to do user interface. You can open window, display a dialog, display a form, whatever you want. It seems natural, but actually, this is not at all natural for an operating system. Most operating systems forbid the usage of user interface from any other thread than the main thread. That means that when you are creating a secondary 4D process, if the 4D process is using internally an operating system thread, managing user interface from this secondary thread is forbidden by operating system. But from cooperative process, inside 4D, we managed to make it possible. In primitive mode, you don't have to call the idle command because it's not the 4D process doesn't have to cooperate to share the CPU. It's done by the operating system. The operating system preemptively gives the CPU to one thread or the other. And if you have multiple CPUs in your machine, then more than one thread can execute at the same time. So the benefit is that you can use all the cores of your machines. But as I said, from a preemptive thread, you cannot do user interface. Quite the same slide as this morning. Just to summarize, in cooperative mode, you have a 4D process executing. Then at some point, you are calling the idle command or some other 4D language command. At this point, process A stops execution and gives the CPU to another process, process B, for example. Then the process B calls the idle command, and in turn, the process A resumes and can execute again. And you can see that the only one CPU is used, and the CPU number two, if you have a second CPU, is doing nothing. In primitive mode, you don't have to call the idle command, and the operating system dispatches the two processes on the two CPU you may have on your machine. So the benefit is obvious. The global execution time is smaller in primitive mode when you have two CPUs. but the execution time of each process individual, in each individual process, is the same. It's not faster for one individual task, for one individual process. Preemptive scheduling doesn't allow any gain in performances. The execution time is strictly the same for one individual process and one individual task. It's the global execution of multiple tasks and multiple processes, which is smaller. Okay, preemptive scheduling actually is not new in 4D. Starting with V11, 4D server is using preemptive scheduling for its own internal task. The DB4D server, the SQL server, and the HTTP server, all these three servers are using preemptive scheduling to take benefit of a multi-core machine. So what is new now in V15, R5, and V16 is preemptive scheduling for the 4D language. And particularly the new process command of the 4D language. So let's start with a quick demonstration. So this is a Node-UI demonstration database we provide with each individual feature we release in our release. So we try to, each time we release a new our release version, we try to provide you with small databases to demonstrate each individual features. You can see the screen, yes. So this is very simple. I have two buttons. Each button is creating four processes. The first one is creating four cooperative processes to do some computation, some stupid computation for the demo. So it's running. So the total time is 640 ticks, and each process individual time is 150. So if you do the math, 150 multiplied by 4, it's roughly 600. So the global time is simply the addition of each individual time. If I do exactly the same computation in four preemptive threads, you see that each individual time of each process is roughly the same, 150, but the global execution time is four times smaller, 160. It's roughly the same as one individual process time. This is because on this laptop, I have four cores, so the four processes, the four 4D processes, are running on each process core. So you see that the benefit for execution, the global execution time, the benefit is obvious. Okay, you must do something in your code to be prepared to take advantage for multicores. The first thing to do is easy. Use 64-bit 4D applications. So as a reminder, 4D server is available on both Mac and Windows now. And the 64-bit version of 4D single user and 4D volume license, we are available today as a preview for our release program and will be released very soon. Then your 4D application must be compiled in order for your 4D process to run in preemptive mode. It seems obvious because preemptive scheduling is for performances. And if you are seeking for performances, you must compile your database. And you must use preemptive ready 4D language commands. Not all 4D language commands are allowed to run in a preemptive 4D process. As I said, for example, user interface is forbidden. So the dialog command, open window command, these commands are forbidden in a preemptive process. So you must take care not to clearly choose the commands you used from your project method to be able to run your project method in a preemptive process. To help you knowing what commands are available in preemptive mode, we will update the documentation to signal, you see the animation on the right? So there's a new icon next to the command to signal the command which are compatible with the preemptive mode of 4D. Something more, you must declare your project method for preemptive. That what I mean is that you must say, tell 4D, okay, I want this project method to take benefit of multicores. I want this project method to run in a preemptive 4D process. So it's very easy. It's a new setting in your project method. I will show you in 4D in a minute. Three radio buttons. I want preemptive scheduling. I want cooperative scheduling, or I don't care. And by default, all your methods are using the I don't care option. If you are converting an old 4D database to the new version of 4D, by default, all your methods are I don't care in the I don't care mode, indifferent. This declaration is important to help you, because at compile time, when you are compiling your database, 4D compiler will check what you are actually doing in your project method code to verify if your code is actually complying with what you are with what you want. 4D compiler will detect if you are using legitimate 4D language commands or not. For example, if you say, I want this project method to run in preemptive mode, but 4D compiler detects that you are actually using open window, then 4D compiler will issue a compiler error to signal you, okay, you are asking to run this project method in preemptive, but that's not possible. I cannot do it because you are calling a prohibited command. So back to the teeny demo. This was compiled, so I am switching to interpreted. Just to show you how it is done. Okay. So this is the form. If I open the object method of the first button, the object method of the second button. So you see that the code is very similar. It's just a loop to create four processes. The only difference is that the second button is calling a launch preamp project method, and the first button is calling the launch coop project method. This is the only difference. So when I look at the code of these two project methods, they both call the compute project method, very simple. And the compute project method, as I said, is doing very stupid computation for the demo with a big loop just to use the CPU. So what are the difference between launch coop and launch preamp? The difference is the method properties. So as you can see here, there's a new setting for your project method. The first option is, I want this method to run in a preemptive process. The second option is I don't want. And the third option is I don't care, indifferent. Okay. This is a method property. So for the launch preamp, so I checked the first option to say I want this project method to run in preemptive process. And launch the first one is I don't want this project method to run in a preemptive process. This is the only difference. Okay? This is the only thing you have to do to launch some computation in a preemptive process. So now that just to show you the detection at compile time, if I compile this database, I'm doing check syntax is faster. Okay, no error. It's normal because the demo was running in compile mode, so there's no error. Okay, now in the launch preamp, say I am using a forbidden command. Message is forbidden because message is doing some user interface. I compile it and I get an error. For the compiler, say, okay, I cannot do what you are asking. You are asking to run this method in a preemptive process. It's not possible because you are using the message command. This is only because you checked this option, okay? If I remove this option, the error disappears, okay? I check it again. Remove this. So now what happens if I am editing the compute method to call message? So remember, compute is called by both launch preamp and launch co-op. I have only one error because for the compiler detects that launch co-op is calling compute, launch preamp is calling compute, but only launch preamp is willing to run in a preemptive process. So there is an error for launch preamp, not for launch co-op. Okay? So the error says launch preamp cannot be run in a preemptive process because it is calling the compute project method, and the compute project method is calling a forbidden for the language command. So it's like contamination. The message command contaminates the compute project method, and then the compute project method contaminates the launch preamp project method. Okay? So you can see that as a help for you to make sure you will be able to take advantage of your multicores. It's an error, but it's easy to, okay, I don't care, I want to do my user interface, I want to use message for debugging purpose. It's easy, you just temporarily switch off the preemptive mode of your project method, all the compile error disappears, and you can do whatever you want. It just, you can see that as an assistance for you to make sure that in production environment, your project method will run at full speed. To run at full speed, to take advantage of preemptive scheduling, the only thing to remember is that you must ask only for the method, the project method you pass to the new process command, and only this one, you must declare it as willing to run in a preemptive mode. Only this one. That's enough. Okay, other thing to be prepared about, no inter-process variables. Okay, so it seems strange, and I'm pretty sure you are all using inter-process variables, but we have a solution. First, why interprocess variables are forbidden in preemptive mode? For example, take this very simple instruction. It is the most simple line of instruction you may have in your code. Incrementing an interprocess variable, myvar equal myvar plus one. In cooperative mode, it's okay. The instruction line is atomic because you are not calling idle inside the instruction line. You are not giving the CPU to another process that could execute exactly the same line of code at the same time. You are pretty sure it won't happen. You are actually very sure it won't happen. Because you are calling, maybe you are calling idle before or after, but not inside your instruction line, okay? So maybe you didn't realize it, but this line of code is atomic. And this is good if you are calling this line of instruction for multiple processes at the same time. This is necessary to be atomic. But in preemptive, remember that there's no use for the idle command because it's like as if the system is calling the idle command for you automatically at any time. So it's a bit like as if the idle command was called by the system in the middle of your instruction line at any time, at any point, anywhere. So, for example, it is as if the behavior would be like a bit like that. So your line of instruction is no longer atomic. So bad thing would happen because if more processes, 10 processes are doing exactly the same, one process is picking the value of myvar, another process is picking the value of myvar, each incrementing the temporary value, and then set back the temporary value to the same variable. Then you will lose some incrementation. To protect against this, you would have to use a semaphore to make sure your line of instruction is atomic by using a semaphore like this, with a timeout, with a clear semaphore, checking, and so on. You may want to adapt your code for each individual instruction, line of instruction, anywhere in your code where you are using interprocess variable, you would have to use this kind of code to protect with a semaphore. It's possible if you are courageous. It's possible. It is a huge work, I imagine, in your code. It is a huge work, and it is really, really inefficient because calling semaphore and calling clear semaphore, calling if, and if, and so on, is 1,000 times slower than just incrementing a variable. So if you are doing this, it will work. The instruction will be atomic. It will work, but it will be 1,000 times slower. So totally inefficient. That's the reason why we decided just not to follow this way. Preemptive scheduling, we must avoid race condition. We must avoid semaphores because semaphores are very complex to use properly. And actually, semaphore is the source of performance problem. So we tried to propose you something better and something else. So how do you share information between processes if you don't have interprocess variables? Workers, as Jean-Pierre introduced them, what is a worker? It's a message box associated with a process dedicated to execute the message of this message box, okay? So we are introducing here a way to exchange information between your 4D processes. One very simple command, call worker, to post a message from one process to another, to ask to send him information, or to ask him to ask it to do something. So the syntax of the call worker command is very similar to the new process command. You pass a destination worker or destination process. You may see a worker like a process. Any project method to execute inside the destination worker, and any parameter you want. A little animation to explain the behavior. From the application process, say you want to pass information to another process, to the my worker process. Okay, so my the application process is running, the my worker process is paused, is nothing to do. So the application process, you are calling the call worker command to say I want to pass information to my worker, and I want my worker to execute my method with my params. So this constitutes a message. The message is posted asynchronously in a message box dedicated to the worker process. The signal is up, so the worker awakes automatically, picks the message, gets what's inside the message, execute my method and the params. When the worker process has finished executing my method, it doesn't die. It just pause, waiting for another message to execute. This is very important when compared to the new process command. The new process command, you launch a new process, execute a method with some parameters, and the process dies. But a worker, that's the main difference. The worker awaits for any message to execute a method with parameters, and then it doesn't die. It just awaits for another message. When does the worker die? When you close an application, when you close your database, of course, all the worker dies automatically. Or when you are calling the new command, kill worker. Kill worker, you with any parameter, just kill the current worker. So the worker commits suicide. Or you can pass a parameter to say, I want this worker to die. But it's polite, so it doesn't abruptly kill the process. It just sends a message to the worker to say, okay, please commit suicide. So it's very simple. Workers are not reserved to preemptive processes. It works also with cooperative processes. It's messaging between processes. So from the application process, I have a dialogue. I click on this button. So I will open the Runtime Explorer. Okay, you see that there's no worker process yet. The first time I click call worker, you see that the process is automatically created. This is what is nice with call worker. You don't have to manage the status of the process, of the worker process. At the first message, the worker process is automatically created for you. So there is a log of the activities. The first line in the list box here say, okay, I am calling call worker, and the second line comes from the worker itself, say, okay, I received your message. No fancy stuff here. If I call it again, it doesn't create another process. It just because the process is already there, the worker is identified by the name. The name of the worker is unique. So 4D knows that the worker or process already exists, so it doesn't create a new one. It just sends him the new message, and the worker processes the message. Then I'm calling kill worker here to ask politely as a worker to commit suicide. And you see that the process is now aborted. I will show you the code. But the code is actually very obvious. Okay, so addIndB is a project method to add the activity log inside the list box. So it's not very important, just to have a message. Call worker, one single line of code. I am passing the worker name, the worker project method, then two parameters. So it's arbitrary, but for the demo, I decided to pass as the first parameter a verb. It's an action code for the worker to tell him something specific to do with a second parameter. And if for the kill worker, it is the same. The verb change, I tell him to stop. Okay? But this is the same kind of code. If I am opening the worker project method, I think this is typical code you may have already in your application. You have a project method with a $1 parameter is an action code to ask your process something specific to do. So I have here two different actions. Call, this is the message. Okay, just to say, okay, I did receive your message. And stop to say, okay, you're asking me to commit suicide, so I am killing myself. Okay? Note here that in this demo, I am using only one project method with an action parameter. But I could implement it differently with two project methods. With instead of using an action code in $1, I could have implemented two project methods, worker call and worker stop. It is the same. It's free for you to do the way you want. Okay, so it's a mind shift, replacing interprocess variables with workers. What's the relation between interprocess variables and workers? Actually, interprocess variables, where you are certainly using them inside your application, is a way to share information between your processes. So workers is a way to do messaging between your processes, so to share information between your processes. This is the logic behind. It is very different. Maybe it's sometimes a bit more complex, but the benefit is efficiency. It is a lot more efficient. It's a lot less complex because you don't have to deal with semaphores. Not a single semaphore in my demo. No deadlocks. No wait time. It's efficient, and you are taking advantage of multicores at full speed. It is asynchronous messaging in 4D. Okay, another precaution is not to use user interface. So I explained it earlier. And for this point, we too are proposing a solution to provide a preemptive process to access to the user interface. Call form. So as Jean-Pierre demonstrated this morning, actually it's very similar to call worker. It's a message box. But this time, it's not a message box associated to a process. It's a message box associated to a window. So call forms allows you to send a message to a window to ask the form running inside the window to execute a project method with parameters. And call form, the call form command is very similar to the call worker command. The first parameter is the identifier of the window to which you want to send a message. The second parameter is the name of the project method you want to run. And the remaining parameters are the parameters you want to pass to the project method. The same kind of animation, because the concept is the same. From one process or one worker, it could be a preemptive process. You want to do something inside a form, a running form elsewhere. It could be the same process if the originating process is cooperative, but it could be another process. You are calling call form with a window identifier. The window identifier is actually the long integer written by the open window command. When you are creating a window, open window is returning you the window identifier. You use this to identify the window. Then the project method name and the parameters encapsulated in a message, posted inside the message box associated to the window. Then the my window, the process handling the window is detecting this automatically, takes the message and execute the method with the parameter. And then the process continues the normal way to manage the window, handling events, key down and most down and so on. A demo. Okay, here it's a very simple demo. There's no workers, there's no multiple process. It's only call forms, calling forms inside the same single process, just to make very simple, to make it clear. So here I am creating a modeless dialogue, a second modeless dialogue, you know, with the star parameter in the dialogue command to create a modeless dialogue. And for this one, I am adding some text in my list box. And with this button, I am also adding some text in my list box. Then I can close this window, close this one. Okay? I am sure you're able to do this already. But here I am using call form. And I will show you the code, and I think the code will appear very simple. Okay, for the first button to open the window, what I am doing, just opening the window, take the reference, the identifier of the window, calling dialog with the star parameter to make the window modeless. Actually, the show window is not necessary. I don't remember why, but okay. And immediately, I am calling the window. I am using the call form command to say, hey, I want to change the background. You notice that the two windows have a blue background and a red light background. So this is done here. Immediately after creating the dialogue, I am asking the form to run a project method to set the color of the background inside the form. As you can see, I am just one single line of code, object set RGB color. So the benefit is obvious here, because the project method is running in the context of the form, running in the previous window. If you are calling directly object set RGB color without call form, it would not work. Because after calling dialog with the star parameter, the dialog is not the current form. You cannot access the object inside the dialogue you just opened with dialogue star. Okay? By using call form, you can execute a project method in the context of a specific form. So you can have access to all the objects running in this form. Okay? Similarly, if I want to add some text in the list box inside my form, I am just calling call form to execute my do add message project method with some parameter, with the originating process, current process name. This command is new, actually. current process name. You have current process which returns the current process number. Now you have the current process name which returns the current process, actually, name. And the do add message is very simple. I use object get pointer to get the pointer to the array used by the first column of my list box inside my current form, insert in array to put it put the text at the top of the array and initialize the array element value. This is working because call form is executing this code inside the context of the form I pass as a parameter. So this is very powerful. With call form, you can manipulate any object of any form from anywhere, because here I am using only one process, but it is working from any process to any other process. So you can imagine that from any process, including a preemptive process, you can do this. You can, from a preemptive process, you can manipulate a list box running in another process very easily. Without any semaphore, without only for this dealing with the interblocking mechanism when necessary for you, it's efficient and it doesn't prevent you to take full advantage of multicores for even when you must use the user interface. This one. Okay, one last demo is a demo combining both call worker and call form. It's a very shrunk version of the demo of from Jean-Pierre this morning. Okay, the purpose here is to create preemptive processes doing computation. Okay, so I clicked five times. Yes, so creating five processes. Each process is doing some computation, and I want each process to have its own console window where I can see the activity of the associated process. So from my worker code, I am calling the main application process to open a dedicated window where the worker will be able to append some message to expose its activity to the end user. Okay? So all of these windows, I have six windows here, all of these windows are running in the same application, in the same application process. Okay? And when the worker is running, it is using call form. Very similar code similar to the demo I just showed you before, to insert an element inside the array of one specific window, the window associated to the worker. From the main controller window, I can communicate with my workers to just, okay, what is your status? Did you finish my work? Are you done? Or whatever you want. And I can ask them to suicide. So here to suicide, you have many possibilities. You can directly call kill worker with the name of the worker you want to kill, or here because you not only have to kill the process, but you also have to close the window associated to the process. So I can show you a trick to associate the window with my worker. So this is the object method to create a worker. with the project method, the worker. Okay, so this is the same principle I used before. I have in $1 a verb, an action code to tell my worker to do something specific. So it's convenient to have many actions in the same project method, all in one code. It's sometimes it's convenient, more convenient to, than multiple tiny project method. So the very first action is create. And the very first thing the worker is doing when it is creating is calling call worker. The number, the very first parameter is one. What does this mean? Is I am calling the application process. The application process is the process number one in 4D, always. Okay. So the application process is now a worker. You can call it with call worker to do whatever you want. So I am asking the application process to execute the my message project method. So the my message project method in the application process is responsible to managing the windows associated to each worker. So here, the trick I was talking about to associate a window with a worker, it is to use a C object. A C object, you can see a C object as an hash table. It is an associative container. It is very efficient and very easy to use as a way to associate something to another thing. Okay? So here, in $1, I was passing the name of the worker. And I use it, the name of the worker, as the property name in my object to know if the window is already associated to this worker or not. If it is not already associated, the OB is defined to tell if the property is there or not there. Say, OK, this is the first time, so the property is not there. So I know I have to open the window here. I get the window identifier here. And I store the window identifier for this worker as a property in my object whose name is the name of the worker. So it's very simple after. The second time I am trying to access the window associated to the worker, I just have to use obget with the property as the property name, the name of the worker. Obget my worker, it returns the identifier of my window in one single line of code, and this line of code is very efficient. Then I am calling call form. Know that I know to what window I need to talk to. I am calling the add message, and the add message command is very similar to what you already saw. It is the same code for every window, accessing the pointer to the first column of my list box, just to insert some text inside my list box. So just to get back to finish with some wrap-up slides, preemptive scheduling is reserved to 64-bit, to the 64-bit product line. If you want performances, it's a no-brainer. Go 64-bit, compile your code. 64-bit was there with V12 for the server. You know that already, with ODBC driver. In V15, we introduced for the Write Pro, for the View Pro, and 64-bit. For the server, 64-bit is available on Mac, so you have for the server 64-bit on both platforms now. In V15, R3, I think, R4 and R5, you have the whole product line as a preview. The work is finished for development, but we want to make sure we are killing the last bugs. Okay, so we are polishing all the stuff, so you won't get any surprise. As you have seen during the keynote, for example, we had to to redevelop stuff like the quick report, the label editor, because these were very old code, and we had to rewrite all the stuff. So this is a major work. It's completed now, and we are finalizing the last remaining bugs. So please participate during this preview period to send us the weird behavior you may see still during this preview. Okay. But it's going pretty well. Internally at 4D, we are all using the 64-bit product line. And we are pretty confident. During this summit, most demonstrations are done using the 64-bit product line. What you have seen here during my presentation was using a 64-bit version of 4D on Mac. So no crashing, no bug for so far. So we are pretty confident we will be able to release the 64-bit product line for Mac, at least in R5. In R5, there will be what you saw here regarding workers, call forms, and preemptive scheduling. And V16, we will continue to generalize preemptive scheduling, especially regarding the server, the application server for triggers, and the dynamic HTTP server, because the HTTP server currently is using preemptive scheduling only for the static pages. So of course, we will take advantage of preemptive scheduling for the 4D language inside your dynamic HTTP pages also, and for your triggers also for 4D server. This is what I was saying. So this is a chart to say, just to spot what is scheduled preemptively in V11, V13, V15, V16. So the various servers and so on. This is not new for most of you. My last slide. So 64-bit arrives with great scalability, great performances, with workers on call forms, you know, have asynchronous messaging inside 4D. This is a key to have efficient code, no deadlock, no hard-to-use semaphores, and yet benefit from your multicores machine. Thank you. Yes? What about get process variable and set process variable?
If you want to get a process, you use those commands to get or set a process variable from another process, and what would be preemptive enabled?
We are still thinking about making them available. Currently, they are not available, but it is possible. But if they are ultimately available in preemptive processes, they will be a lot slower. So keep in mind that eventually, if these commands are available and legitimate from preemptive processes, they will be much slower, because we have internally to use a semaphore, a lock, and because we cannot stop a process to read its variables and ask the process to continue. We have to implement some kind of rendezvous to say to the process, okay, during your execution, maybe you are inside a while true loop or something. Okay, I want to ask you something. So at some point during your computation, you must check some flag to see if someone is tapping on your elbow to say, hey, I want to read your variable. Okay, so we need to implement some kind of rendezvous inside each code. So it's, and we cannot put this kind of rendezvous anywhere, because it will slow down everything. So it will be complex and much, much slower.
What about This is what I do with the demo. In the demo you have seen this morning, I have 8 workers, 16 workers updating the screen. So the way of thinking is different. I do not get process variable from the screen itself, from the window, from the floor, but I do a kind of set process variable on the worker. Periodically, every tenth of second, for instance, or every second, I send a message by the code form, and then this form, just the method in the form, just puts all together these different data coming from the different processes in order to explain what you have to respond. So the thing is not, I am going to get the data from the worker. The way of thinking is the worker is going to push the data when he's in a place where he can get it on your cooperative.
Yes. Just to finish because the session is done, but you must think about messaging like emails. You know, when you are asking something to someone, you send an email. You don't get what you are asking immediately. To get what you are asking, your body must send an email back to you to provide you with the information you are asking. So the response is another email. So the communication is not, I am sending you and I get something. No, I am sending a message, and the body is sending a message back to provide you with what you are asking. So it's both-way communication. Thank you. I must read the room.